Welcome back to another episode of Inside of Her C-Suite. We go inside of FNB Joburg Art Fair to talk to Pamela Joyner, who's come all the way from America to talk about her collection. She has an MBA. She can make the connection between business and art. Let's go. Hi, Pamela. Thank you so much.
Good to see you.
It's such a pleasure to be able to have a conversation with you. Welcome to Joburg Art Fair.
Thank you. My pleasure. It's always good to be back in Joburg. I feel like it's home.
Absolutely. Now, one of the reasons why I wanted to bring you inside of our C-suite, this show, is particularly because of your background in business as an MBA and your history in sort of business and finance. You know, being able to use finance to influence economies and tell stories, there's a bit of a link between that and art, right?
Well, there is, and people don't really think about it this way, but art is a big global business. And so while it has this aesthetic component, it has all of the attributes that any large business has. And something that I think has been really important for me in business is to learn the real value of relationships. And the relationships are essential to the art business because of all the players who are knit together. So it's a perfect melding for me of both skill sets.
Wow. Take us back to you, a young girl,
a young woman,
growing up in America, you sort of frolicking about your teenage years. Were you always interested in beautiful aesthetics? Were you always interested in, how the power of the aesthetic at all? When did you become interested?
I really can't remember a day when I wasn't interested in aesthetics. That, in large part, is attributable to my parents, who, grew up in an era and grew up in the Jim Crow South. And one thing that they knew for sure was that their children would have better prospects than they themselves had. And so they wanted to do everything to facilitate that process. And they had a view and implemented this view that the notion of being cultured was really important. So I don't remember a time when I didn't spend time in museums and going to theater. I had a particular interest in classical ballet and the classical performing arts. And so this is just life for me, and it's always been life. And so sometime during my sort of maturation process, probably during business school, I decided that it was important to be a patron of the arts, and so I've endeavored to do that throughout my adult life.
So you grew up in Chicago.
I did.
Grew up in Chicago, and Chicago is well known for prominent African Americans, like the association between the Obamas, people like yourself, and so forth. During that time, was there a recognition or a gap? Is that where you saw the gap between the idea that Africans throughout the diaspora may not have been recognized for the phenomenal works that we've produced?
Well, yeah, I mean, that really became very clear even in the very local culture. So you'd go to the museum and you'd see these fabulous works, the Picassos, the Seurats. The Art Institute of Chicago, where I'm a trustee, is well known globally for its very in-depth impressionist collection. But then you'd look on the walls and then you'd see not very much representation by African Americans of African Americans. And so that just leapt off the page, especially in an environment where, I mean, that city, is currently about a third African American at the time I grew up, even larger. And so that was a real, sort of wake-up call and a real dilemma. And so I think we were all very aware of that.
So we'll talk about the residency and the art collection in a moment, but I want to stick here. Your background for me is really, really fascinating in that, you also have a marketing background.
I do.
So you understand not only the business, but how to move things and images and so forth. Just draw for me a link between marketing and art for a moment.
Well, I mean, we're in the midst of, a marketing exercise at an art fair. I mean, this is a large part of how art gets marketed globally. But I think there are nuances here. So for instance, one does not simply transact between a dealer and a collector. The galleries are very valued advisors because they have lots of information about artists, and if you develop a proper relationship with prominent dealers, they can really aid you in your process of accumulating iconic artworks that can have a long-term impact. And I'd say that is more true in South Africa than it is almost anywhere else I go, in part because the market is still evolving and emerging. And so there are prominent dealers that have almost an old world style of interacting with clients. It's a much more advisory, collaborative kind of process rather than just a transactional process.
Wow, and for those who are completely intimidated by this whole art world, I mean, you've mentioned earlier off camera that oftentimes you go, you know, our demographic, we have a mixed demographic watching this show, from whites, blacks, and so forth, but often you go in those early days, you found yourself as the only African there or African American there. Demystify this whole art world for me. And let's talk a little bit about the complexities of being a person as an outsider coming into a world where you're an out-group member.
So, I mean, like any industry, this world is complex. It has its own set of rules. So there are a couple of key constituents. The galleries and dealers are a key constituency. The curators and critics are a key constituency. And the collectors are, you know, another constituency. And I think what's really fun for me is that the whole ecosystem is a world of learners. And so when you begin to forge relationships with each type of key constituency, you learn how to navigate from a position of being outside to a position of being more inside. And any one individual or collection of individuals can help you in that regard. So, you know, my advice would be, you know, pick one or two. Get to know those individuals and organizations, and the learning process will be iterative. You'll figure out how to navigate the system. And people call me all the time and I ask for advice, and I'm always happy to. Advice is a dangerous thing to give, but I can tell people about my experience, and everybody has their own experience and their own way of navigating this environment.
So the story behind art is extraordinarily important, what it means to the history, etc. For someone who's just starting out in this sort of, who's interested in art world, where do they begin? Do they log on www.howtostartinart.com? Where do we begin?
So one place to begin is to buy a bunch of art books. And that's something I did, you know, 20 plus years ago. And I didn't realize how many books I had until we had to write a book and someone asked me to produce a bibliography. I think we own something like 700 art books. And they're scattered all around my house. I didn't even realize we had that many until I had to catalog them. So that's one place to start. Another place to start is at a venue like this. Just walk the fairs and talk to the dealers and ask them about this artist, and they'll tell you everything. And you can see, as you go from booth to booth, they're very different things. This aesthetic is very different from the aesthetic around the corner. And that's another way to learn. Museums are probably the best place to learn. Just go and decide what you like. Museums all have great bookstores. And then through that, you'll meet probably, you know, people associated with museums. The galleries will direct you to people who know, you know, something about that piece of artwork. And then you develop this network, not unlike in business. You develop a whole network that is comprised of your social capital. And then you decide what you can afford to buy. So some people start with prints. Some people start with emerging artists who really don't have much of a profile where the work is more affordable. Some people can start other places that are much more lofty. That wasn't my particular set of circumstances. We started sort of from the ground up, and we've gone from there.
Just thinking about your sort of ideas around the diaspora and African diaspora, part of your mission in your story is to sort of shift the narrative. But tell us a bit more about what your real passion is around your mission.
So we really started when we discovered, you know, 2 decades ago, the extent to which, first, African-American artists were underrepresented in every way. They were underrepresented in the gallery system, they were underrepresented in the museums, and underrepresented in the prominent collections. And so, as we understood that story, our mission developed to be one where we're trying to rewrite that history. Then over the years, we learned that, in fact, that's a global scenario. And there are artists, you know, throughout the diaspora globally whose stories have not been told. So we're trying to tell stories that have not been told. And some of those stories are artists who made work yesterday. That's a work that's coming to our home. And it's a 2016 work by an artist who lives here in South Africa. And then there's work that dates back to the oldest work in our collection. We really think of our collection as starting in as being a post-World War II collection starting in 1945, but the oldest work is from 1930.
Yeah. Saw that, wow. And do you feel, and because this is such a complex space, there's a lot of issues around diversity, social dynamics, that if people understood Africans and African Americans' ability to contribute valuable pieces, that they would see us differently?
Yeah, I think that philanthropy is really, really, really important, and that's another part of the learning. I am really encouraged by and very optimistic about the receptivity of the art world to stories about the African diaspora, but I think that it's incumbent upon collectors who own that material to reveal it, to share it, to steward the careers, so that institutions and other collectors aren't left with blind spots where they don't know who these artists are. And so there might have been a time when the system was less receptive. We are not in that moment. I think the system is sponge-like in its interest and ability to absorb and incorporate those stories, because we are all about incorporating those stories into the context of the full arc of the art history canon.
Got it. Finally, take us to your residency. Who are the type of people you want in your residency?
People we love to live next door to us. So it's really an informal sort of residency. Any artist who qualifies to be in our collection could qualify to participate in the residency. We also have scholars writing about the same subject matter that we have an interest in doing the residency. And so the way it works is people raise their hand and say, I would like to come to the residency, and I take a look on the calendar and see if there's space, and I ask, you know, how long you're going to be there. And that's just really pretty much how it works, and it's been going since 2014. We just hosted for several months Mikhail Sabotsky, who lives here in Johannesburg and is one of the artists in our collection. One of his works is on the cover of our book, and it was a great experience for us. We hope it was a great experience for him.
Wow. Well, I am really grateful to have had this conversation, and we're going to go check out your book now. And I want to encourage people across the continent, throughout the diaspora, to make sure you get a copy of your book. Thank you so much for allowing us inside your C-suite.
Thank you.
Awesome.
Is this okay?
Thank you.